All right, peace and blessings, and welcome to another episode of YB's Collaboration Corner in conjunction with Self-Publishing 30 Days. I am your host, Rob YB Youngblood, President of Sales for Self-Publishing 30 Days, and I have the pleasure of being here with Ralph Smithers Jr. Ralph and I had the opportunity to connect while I was taking a road trip to Columbus, Ohio to support one of our newest authors, Marlon Moore, who's a fraternity brother of mine and a big deal. Like Marlon is a pretty big deal. But right now we've got Ralph on. Ralph is a pretty big deal as well. He'll tell you a little bit about himself. Welcome to the podcast, Ralph. How are you doing today?
I am doing great, Rob. It's great to be with you this morning.
I love it. So let's cut right to it, Ralph. So your background, you're in the insurance arena, but tell us a little bit about your backstory. We'll get to you what you do in a moment, but tell us a little bit about yourself. You're native of Columbus, Ohio, correct?
Yeah, I was born and raised here in Columbus. I went through the public school system. I went to Ohio State, which is part of the public school system as well. I didn't really know what I wanted to do, or I thought I did, but I didn't really know what I wanted to do, and I'm still trying to figure that out. But I ended up in the insurance business.
Yeah, that's good. That's good. And I'm sure in insurance, you know, there's a ton of relationship building that you have to do to be successful. Is that correct?
Insurance is all about relationships. In our business, if your house burns to the ground or you get in a bad car accident, it's one thing for someone to show up and write a check to try to make it right, but you need to have someone there that, one, sets you up with the right coverage to begin with, that has empathy and concern in a time of need, and is able to support you through the process. So those customer service skills are something that I really have drawn on in my own journey for collaboration and networking.
Absolutely. And so you're not just in the insurance industry, you're actually representing diversity, equity, and inclusion. Let's talk a little bit about your current role and how did you get to where you are today?
Well, I appreciate you asking that. So I am the AVP of Diversity, Equity, Inclusion, and Community Relations. Don't ask me to say that again, because it's a lot of words. Yeah. But I came into this role from basically filling in needs that we had in our company. Our last CEO had a company vision actually for 2021, and we went through a very painstaking process to identify our strengths, weaknesses, and opportunities. And as it turns out, we wanted to do better as far as having a formalized relationship and process with our community. And even back in 2015, you know, years before George Floyd occurred, our company was working on trying to make sure that our company looks like the communities that we serve and that we have the proper support systems in place. So I was asked to kind of build that up from scratch. And here we are today.
I love it. So Was this a direction that you knew you wanted to go into, or did it kind of come as a result of the relationships that you built along the way?
This definitely came as a result of the relationships. In fact, if someone had told me 10 or 15 years ago that I would have been doing this, I would have been horrified. Yeah. And the reason is that a lot of these roles, and I hate to use the word token, but you know, they will put a person of color sometimes in those community roles, in those diversity roles, which I earlier in my career sort of felt were expendable. So I would have been very reluctant or concerned if I knew that my career path would take me there. Mm-hmm. But as it turns out, I spent 8 years of my career in our company's training department. I was pretty good at it. I ended up becoming the manager. And this was before our CEO became the CEO. So he had a chance to see me work. And I was also on a board with him on a nonprofit that he started. So I think that some of those strengths and aptitudes were on display. And when the opportunity arose, I was asked to do it. And like I said earlier, we built it completely from scratch.
Yeah, that's good. That's good. So let's talk about your definition of collaboration, because we, you know, on the YB's Collaboration Corner, obviously, we're talking about relationships. We're talking about networking. What is your definition of collaboration?
Yeah, I think collaboration is bringing forces together that have a common interest and a common purpose to try to get synergy, to make 1 + 1 = 3.
Yeah.
So sometimes there may be even an element of competition, or I call it co-opetition, maybe the two organizations or two entities are trying to go after the same thing, but they figure out a way to be better together.
I love it. So talk a little bit about what has been your biggest, I guess, hurdle when it comes to collaboration. Like, have you had to overcome challenges when it came to, you know, just building those collaborative efforts?
Well, I think the biggest challenge that I've had is that as we were getting started with this process, our company went through a merger, and a lot of things were either put on hold or they had to be reset. And I had to also adapt to different level of resources being available. That would probably be my biggest challenge. I've been pretty good through my career getting people on board, and some of the roles that I've had in the past, particularly in customer service and underwriting, where one, you have to take care of your customer, you have to understand their needs and be responsive. But in underwriting, that's a role where sometimes you go through that entire process, and at the end, you have to tell a person no,
right. But
then you have to come back and work with them the next day. So those backgrounds certainly help me in this role. But sometimes it's just a matter of just me wanting to go at 150 miles an hour when I only have enough gas to go 45.
Right.
So it's a matter of working through it.
So what, give me an example of a time where a collaboration actually came together and worked for your good. Like, you know, like it was just a phenomenal experience. Talk a little bit about that for me.
Yeah, we've had quite a few of those in our organization, especially through the DE&I process. I think that some of the more effective collaborations have occurred where maybe we work real hard on our end to secure a guest speaker that maybe is at least locally or nationally well known, but we have a competitor that might have the same kind of, say, a resource group that's trying to get established. We routinely send out invitations for those organizations to come and participate. In fact, that's how I, you referenced Marlon Moore earlier, and that's how I got to know him. We used to do a lot of collaborations when he was with Huntington Bank,
right.
To a point where we were actually part of their program, and, you know, things were really good on a recent program.
Yeah, I like that. So as we're about to land the plane, talk about what do you look for when it comes to collaboration? Like, you know, what type of relationships are you looking to attract and build relationships with?
So when it comes to collaboration and anything that I get involved with, I like to understand the mission of the person that I'm working with. Sometimes they may have a physical, tangible mission statement, but I want to know where they want to take whatever it is at the end of the day. And if we are going in the same direction, we might have to compromise or negotiate on a few things. But if we're mostly heading in the same direction, then that's usually going to be a good fit. If we're going in opposite directions, or if there's some sort of suspicion or unreasonable level of competition where it's like, hey, you know, this person's going to turn on me at a critical moment, then, right. You know, that might not be a good fit. But we're usually able to work those things out pretty early on.
Yeah, that's good. So I have two last questions for you. Obviously, you're talking to someone who's involved in a publishing arena. So I often ask people this question. If you had the opportunity to go anywhere in the world and write your best-selling book, right? So say, for example, you had an opportunity, you had this idea, you was ready to write your book and self-publish in 30 days, we were going to pay for it. Where would you travel to write your book?
That's a tough question. I would probably want to go near the ocean and palm trees.
Okay.
But I'm also a bit of a homebody, and I think I could perform just as well here in Columbus, where it's starting to get cold and the leaves are changing colors. But somewhere where there's maybe mountains, ocean, and sunshine might be optimal.
I love it.
It's not too distracting.
Oh, yeah, I'm telling you. I mean, for some people, I had one young lady said she would just want to sit out over the ocean and just have a glass bottom and just, I'm like, man. And then other people are like, drop me in Africa. Just anywhere in Africa, just drop me anywhere in Africa.
Well, yeah, Rob, I wish I could give you a more exciting answer, but you know, when it comes down to just getting things done, I sometimes have to turn everything off and just focus.
Yeah, no, that's actually very, very important key to success and when it comes to writing your book. So I love that. So Ralph, tell us how can others get connected to you if they want to collaborate, if they want to learn more about what you do? What's the best way for folks to connect with you?
Yeah, I think the best way to connect with me is on LinkedIn. R. Smithers Jr., which is Ralph Smithers Jr., we'll get you there. And I'm active on LinkedIn. I definitely collaborate, and it's been amazing. Just like our collaboration today, one of the benefits or hidden benefits of the pandemic, if there is such a thing, is that we've been able to really expand our networks beyond just the people that you can see in person, you know, across the country. So that's the best place.
Yeah, I think that's so amazing. And you actually hit the nail on the head in terms of why we do what we do is to, you know, obviously put people in a position to increase their visibility, credibility. But, you know, we recognize we're one connection away from supernatural explosion. So keep doing what you're doing, Ralph. It was a pleasure talking to you. I'm looking forward to us continuing to build, and I'm looking forward to getting back to Columbus. I just want to wear my blue and yellow hoodie that has a big M on it that people think is Michigan State. I'm all Michigan, all Michigan State. I hear Ohio State, they want it. It's us versus everybody, right?
Ohio versus the world is what we say.
Versus everybody, absolutely.
And I'm looking forward to getting back together, and who knows, maybe I'll start putting an outline together. I think that there's a lot of things that I like to share, especially with people that are kind of figuring out things early on in their career that might be helpful.
Well, listen, I know a guy that can help you get started. So when you're ready, I know a guy. I get you collaborated and connected. I know a guy.
Well, we are heading towards a common purpose. So I appreciate that.
I love it. I love it. Well, listen, you all, you've been listening to Ralph Smithers Jr. He's a phenomenal gentleman. Definitely follow up with him, especially if you're in the DEI space and you want to learn how to collaborate and leverage your talents to grow in your career. I'm Rob YB Youngblood, president of sales for Self-Publishing 30 Days. You've been listening to the YB's Collaboration Corner, which is affiliated with Self-Publishing 30 Days. I want you to remember, be encouraged, be blessed, but most of all, continue to share the faith. And the way that you do that is by operating your gift, because your gift will make room for you. We'll talk soon. Peace.